so humbled to present to you our speaker, Dr. Julius Ouma Jwan. I hope I pronounce it correct. Daktari, to start with, is a teacher. I am reliably told that he holds a Bachelor of Education degree in Education and Literature from Moi University. As if that is not enough, he went back to Moi to do a master's degree in linguistics. He was never satisfied with us, with that. He traveled to Norway, where he did another master's degree in education communication. As if that was not enough, he went to the UK, he flew from Norway to UK, where he did another master's in education research. And not being satisfied, he stayed back in the US, in the UK, to do a doctorate in education, leadership and management. And that tells you the caliber of the person who is going to talk to us this afternoon. He's taught in a high school for 6 years, thereafter lectured at Moi University for 13 years. He joined the Commission for National Cohesion and Integration, where he was the director of programs for a few years before joining the KICD, where currently he is the director. And therefore, I am very, very sure that he is the best placed person to handle this topic on curriculum reforms in contemporary Kenya. Dear delegates, I want to welcome you to this afternoon session to listen to Daktari, and I pray that all of us will be attentive. If you need to pray, of course, the traditional way of closing your eyes, let your neighbor pinch you a bit so that you can be very much attentive. Most welcome, Daktari. Talk to your fellow principals. A clap for Daktari, please.
Thank you very much, Father Dr. Lawrence, Mr. Murimi. Good afternoon, colleagues. I'm humbled to have been invited to make this presentation. Such a powerful team of principals. I was telling Augusta that I'm not feeling very well. That's why I have to keep walking with my glass of water. But the thought of sending one of my colleagues to come and make the presentation was not going down well with me, so I decided that I would rather come and drink water, but have a discussion and a conversation with you directly. Most importantly, because I went through Catholic-sponsored schools, and I thought it's an opportunity to engage with principals in these schools. I'm a product of St. Mary's Yala. I hope the principal is here, Mr. Lando. Maybe I'll look for him and say hi, because he was also a young man behind me when we were in St. Mary's Yala. One of the things we learned when we were there, even if I don't practice it, is humility. Humility and simplicity. I said I may not practice it, but I'm sure those who acquired it well, probably like Mr. Lande, if he's around, could be exhibiting quite a bit of that. Another thing that I learned when I was there is just being clean. And being clean here includes being clean in your heart and in the environment where you work with people. And I must admit, I sit in the next board, and last year, as we were administering exams, without being biased, I went to a lot of schools in this country. Each time I found a school that looked very neat, and again, I could be biased, it happened that it was a Catholic-sponsored school.
Wow.
If you think I'm just saying that to please you, then ask the principal of Tartar if she's here. I was thoroughly impressed. St. Anthony's, the principal is here. I went to several schools, including St. Bridget's, St. Mary's Egoji, you know, several schools that I went to. And incidentally, when we came back and we were having a discussion as NEC board in the CS and the PS, because the PS is a member of the board as well, it seemed to have resonated across the board that there are schools that stood out. The only thing that they learned later is that they happen to be Catholic sponsored. So I think if we can all try to make sure that the environment that students live in is neat, I think that gives access to somebody's heart. I must admit that there are also some two schools that I went to that are not Catholic sponsored, and I think they were in a horrible state. I don't want to mention, but you know, if you walk into a school, and as soon as you open the gate, you feel the school is stinking, then you can imagine what those people go through. Unfortunately, one of them is a national school, sadly enough.
Oh,
but allow me not to mention, because I know other, even the TSC secretary, based on the initial reports that we had, also went to those one or two of those schools because they were in a very, very bad state, yet they were very powerful schools. Now, I think that is for another day. For now, allow me to talk about the curriculum. Originally, I was given 1.5 hours. As it is now, 40 is already gone. So the presentation is quite long. The reason why I made it long is that I wanted to include as much information as I could so that there are areas that I will not talk about, but which can be sent to the principals so that you can look at them, interrogate them, and deal with them at your own time. So there are some slides where I will not make much comment. I think one of the main questions that people have always asked, why do we want to reform our curriculum? Some will change it into, why do we want to remove the 844 system? Because my argument is that we basically don't want to remove the 844 system. We just want to reorganize learning. If in the process of reorganizing learning, 844 changes, so be it. So we don't just set out that we want to change the 844 system, but we set out to reorganize learning in what is famously now referred to as the 21st century. You can, I think I'm sure it's visible, about the Constitution requiring us to provide free education to all our learners. And for that to happen, it must be done within a specific context. Most critically, if you look at Article 10 of our Constitution, it starts from Article 4 that says that Kenya is a democratic state founded in certain values and principles which are articulated in Article 10. And if you look at Article 10 and those values, you'll find that they run across the whole Constitution. Later, whether you talk of integrity and leadership, whether you talk of section 232, Article 232 of the Constitution, we talk about the values of public service, you'll find that they are all pegged on values and principles of governance that form what we call Kenya as a country. So that therefore means that we needed to relook at our education system so that what we are learning in school helps us develop as a Kenyan, as one country that is based on specific principles. Equally, Vision 2030, which we are always talking about, the main thing of Vision 2030 is making us a middle-income economy in 2030. And for that to happen, it means there are certain fundamentals economic, social, and political that must be developed in the country so that we move to in that direction. And for that to happen, it means we needed to look at our education system and make it or have it in a manner that it can support that kind of desire that you can't have. But again, globally, you know, UNESCO requires that every 5 years we need to revise our curriculum. Because the world is changing so fast, there's always a need to relook at what we are doing in line with how the world is changing. Unfortunately, our curriculum was last reformed in 2003. The last review was done, our curriculum was last reformed in 1984-85. The last review was in 2003. So that means 13, 14 years down the line, we have never done anything about our curriculum. I'm not saying it is irrelevant, but you can see where we stand as a country. And out of that, the East African community went and signed a protocol that all the East African countries need to adopt a competency-based curriculum, which I will talk about later. Now, as you may be aware, Rwanda rolled out their new curriculum this year, which is competency-based. South Sudan has finished their dealing with the curriculum. They're just waiting to roll out. Uganda rolled out early years. That is primary. They were working on secondary. It stopped sometimes in the course of last year. But again, when the new minister came in, the wife of the president, they have invited it again. And so we need all the countries in East Africa to harmonize our curriculum around competency-based. This is meant to enhance the movement of students across the East African region, and most critically, to enhance the movement of labor, so that when you move from one system to another one, you are not asked that, how sure do we know that what you have learned makes sense in our country. I don't want to talk about sustainable development goal number 4, which talks of quality and equity, I think, and then several other studies also indicate that our system is a bit too examinations oriented, is too heavy at the lower level, and therefore does not give children a chance to remain children. So as this and several other factors made it critical that we need to reform our curriculum and our education system. Now, I just threw this in, not as part of the rationale, but just to give us a comparative look at the structure of education. This one is within the East African region. And one thing that comes out that we keep asking, what is the objective of primary education? And once we identify the objective of primary education, then we go to how many years then do we need for somebody to be in primary schooling? Because the objective basically is to provide foundational skills of literacy, numeracy, and life skills to learners at that age. Make it easy and let the children enjoy learning. After that, you move them to the next level where you give them what we call an expanded curriculum so that they start appreciating the diversity of learning. That is across the world. Because again, I've seen a lot of people have been asking me that now, which is this structure that you're adopting? Which country are you coping from? And I tell them, we are not coping from any country. We are only looking at literature, looking at our situation as Kenya, and then checking across the board how people are dealing with competency-based curriculum. Because this is the direction the world has taken, and as a country, we don't have a choice. Now, we also realize that in the Basic Education Act of 2013, pre-primary is included as part of basic education. And this is done because across the world, that is the way it should be, so that when learners move from nursery or early pre-primary to primary school, it's not a nightmare to them. It is something that is easy and makes them enjoy learning. Not that when they move from nursery, the first day you take them to primary school, they cry the whole day, and we take it that that is normal, that, you know, it's a new environment, they will have to cry. That should never be the case. Now, these are the fundamental questions that normally curriculum developers ask when you want to develop, you want to review, or you want to revise a new curriculum. The main thing is the skills, the knowledge, and the values that you feel should be included in the curriculum. Now, you can read that, but the challenge we have had in this country, especially since I started getting involved in this and I got this job 2.5 years ago, is that in Kenya currently, everybody believes that every problem and every issue that we have in this country should be solved through curriculum. So people, wildlife, come to tell us that, you know, for children to appreciate animal, it must be fully embedded in the curriculum. Human rights should be embedded in the curriculum. It reaches a stage that even people who are doing things that I don't want to mention here are almost telling us that we also include that in the curriculum. That means people see hope in giving certain values in early years to young children, because as they always say, it gets very difficult to bend a tree when it is already old, when it's already big enough. So this is the challenge we have had, and so we always ask ourselves certain fundamental questions when we start looking at the curriculum. What is it that we want to change before I come to competence-based curriculum? We want to move away from just giving young people content to trying to help them develop competencies. Because each of us as a human being has some competencies, has skills, has knowledge that we can develop when it is well nurtured. So that is a focus that we have to move on so that we don't just focus on the content. We also want to make the curriculum just a little flexible. As it is now, I think our curriculum is too rigid. You have to pass certain subjects. If you don't pass them, woe unto you. If you don't get a specific grade, you really have to struggle to move on to the next level. That focus across the world has changed, and therefore, that is part of what you want to do. Another critical component is the introduction of formative assessment to complement summative assessment. Again, this is critical because I've even seen it written in the papers that KICD now wants to remove examinations. You can never remove examinations. Check literature across the world. There's no country that does not have examinations. But they have assessments and is conducted in different ways. That is what we want to do. Because this happens across the world, and that is the direction the world is taking. So that we don't judge a learner based on 2 hours or 1 hour that they sit in a classroom, sit an exam, and then you tell them you're failed, you're a failure. You know, we don't take into consideration any other factors, any other learning, any other assessment that they've done before. Another question that I'm always asked here, that are you sure teachers will not be cheating if they're given a chance to assess them formatively? And I tell the people, they will only cheat if we make that grading at the end the only pinnacle on which teachers can be promoted. And then what to do, which is already been done by KICD and the NEC, is to develop an assessment mode, an assessment framework that gives you a holistic assessment of a child. So that if a child gets an A, then it should be that that child will not get an A, then the following day go to the railway station and approve the railway, not knowing that that railway really serves a purpose that even him or her will benefit from. I think we acknowledge the presence of the bishop. You're welcome. Now, the next thing that we are really focusing on are these animals they keep calling the 21st century skills. What are they and what do they mean for us? I'll give the details later. But this is what they are. I mean, there are things you've seen, problem solving, critical thinking, information literacy, etc., etc. The question is, how do we synthesize this in a manner that adds value to our learning process? One of the things that we have done is reduce the amount of work that children are given in terms of content, so that they spend a lot more time on engaging in activities. Now, when you give them activities and they struggle to solve, they'll think critically, they'll think creatively. Just put them in an environment where that can be done, you give them some key guidelines, and leave them to move on. 21st century skills, just the fact that they're all intertwined. They roll out like wheels, where if one stops, then everything stops. You look at that when you get the presentation. Competence-based education. This is what is going on across the world. Any country you go into now will tell you that they have gone competence-based curriculum. Competence-based curriculum, incidentally, partly, is what we do in our classrooms. Those of us who teach practical subjects, those of us who teach some aspects of sciences, and even some of the arts courses, I can see some of my colleagues are praying. And we are told that when people close their eyes to pray, and you see the knock of their head, it means the prayer is even getting deeper. So, I'll try to make it a bit fast so that we can go for prayers. Actually, I saw time for mass, so that those who are already praying can we avoid starting so early before that time comes. So basically, what I'm trying to say is that competence-based curriculum simply focuses on the activities that children can do, rather than what they just regurgitate. What they can cram and produce in the exams becomes a smaller component. We spend more time on the ability to perform, and that means learning becomes a lot more activity-based than us struggling to finish a syllabus. One of the challenges we are facing now, because we have been doing a pilot, is that teachers get bored. They say the work they have been given is too little, they finish it very early, and then they don't know what to do with themselves. So the training that we are undertaking is to make them appreciate that actually we want it to be that little, and then they engage the learners in more activities that the learners can perform on their own. The main thing is that competence-based curriculum appreciates that we can never be the same, that each of us is unique, and that each of us has abilities, each of us has skills and talents that are never the same. And therefore, we must give people an opportunity to pursue at some level the skills and the competencies that they have. That some of us are only good in running, some of us are good in football, some of us are good in music, some of us are good in maths. And once we appreciate that and nurture that, then it means in the long run, probably shall reduce the number of learners that now we churn out and declare them as failures. So they automatically feel the country has rejected them, and with that change of negative attitude, it becomes a problem when you want them now to do other things. And so when other people come and tell them that we appreciate you, you can come and join us, we'll give you good money, as long as you can go and kill a few, then they feel that is good, because the society already declared them failures. That same society never appreciated that they had skills outside the biology, outside the chemistry, and outside maybe others that our current curriculum insists on. And now, based on that, we went ahead and developed the basic education curriculum framework. Again, this has never been done before, because this is the foundation of what will inform any future review of the curriculum. Now, the problem we have with the current system, and that is why people say it has been watered down, is that we never put benchmarks, what we call the framework within which it needed to operate. So as time went by, it got adjusted and it shifted from what probably the good intention that it had. Because the basic thing was that after the 8 years in primary school, if somebody was not able to proceed to the next level, they were expected to have skills that then they could take the place of work and do whatever practical skills to take the place of work. Unfortunately, learners finish school when they're about 14, 15, 16, when they are therefore considered minors and therefore cannot go to work. And that already is a problem. So we needed to come up with a system that keeps them in school until the time when they need to go to the field of work. Now, in developing the framework, we looked at our national goals of education and we felt that they are good enough. We didn't need to change them. You know, in 1964, there were six. Then, when the curriculum was reviewed, or rather last reformed, they were added and they were increased to eight. Now, when you look at our goals of education, you will agree with me that they are wonderful. And if this was achieved the way that we intended to have them achieved as a country, probably we would be different. We would be more nationalistic, we would appreciate cultural diversity, we would have some sound moral values, so that what happened to us in 2007 and 2008 probably would not have happened. But not just that, even the way we behave now as a country, as a people, you will agree with me that you wonder what we judge, because you've seen this happen. If you can go and steal money or loot resources without being discovered, then the best next thing you need to go and do is to go and contest to be an MP, be a governor, and people will be falling over you. If you talk to young people, they'll say, I want to be like Mr. So-and-so, because he has a lot of money, he drives so many huge vehicles, etc., etc. But you realize that it means how you get it ceases to be a problem. And that our sound moral values were lost somewhere. So, you know, you go to other countries, people come here and they wonder how we manage as a country. Because for us, even when you're driving and you reach a traffic red light, you don't bother. If the police does not stop you and nobody hits you, so be it. Basic things that really should make who we are as a people. The next thing we did, we developed a vision. What is it that we want to drive the curriculum reform process? And we thought that having an engaged, empowered, and an ethical citizen is something that can drive our thinking forward. So that every time we are in schools, every time we look around, if our desire becomes developing somebody who is empowered, somebody who is engaged, somebody who can make themselves busy and be ethical, then probably that can start to be a driving force for what we should be as a people. We then developed a mission, and that is nurturing every learner's potential. Now we looked around and we agreed, after doing research consultations, that each human being has some potential. Each of us has some talent. And if we focus on developing each learner's potential, it means we shall not declare any learner as a failure, because somebody who cannot pass one subject will be good in another one. And I always remember in my primary school, we always had some of our colleagues who are very good in art and craft. I don't know whether they still do art and craft in primary school, making ropes, making some small, and some of us would be extremely good. But if you took them to class and you wanted them to pass your mathematics, then you would be in trouble. We never appreciated that the skills they had in that art can actually earn them a living, because the things they make are the same thing that some of us now import from China. Now, the next stage, we decided to identify our values that we thought are critical for the country, guiding principles and theoretical approaches. Now, the theories that we look at here, each of them touches on a certain component of our learning. Whether you talk of the multiple intelligence theory, it simply appreciates that human beings always have different intelligences, and they are multiple. Now, some are stronger than others, and if you find one is strong in one person, then that is what we need to develop. We then decided to identify what we call the core competencies, because if we talk of competence-based curriculum, it means we must help our teachers identify what we mean by the competencies that by the end of the learning period, somebody should acquire, somebody should be able to communicate, should be able to collaborate with others, because we are a multicultural society, and if we are not able to collaborate, it means even in our places of work, we'll have problems. Now, what we did is to go ahead and in each of these competencies, we identified how we can identify them, what it means, the examples, and the expected outcome. So for each of the competencies, we went ahead and then let's say you talk of citizenship, and when you say citizenship is a competency, what does it mean? This is somebody that is empathetic, somebody is a good steward, who is responsible, and then how do you deal with this within a classroom situation? So we have done that for all the core competencies, and these competencies run across all the learning areas, and they also run across all the levels of education system. Now, the next thing what we did is now to look at what we call organization of learning in basic education. And that is what some people then refer to as structure. Now, we looked at literature, we looked at research, and I should have also mentioned that before we even embarked on this program, we did a need-a-sneeze assessment across the country. I'm sure some of you were interviewed by our colleagues when they came across on what Kenyans want about our education system. Now, we came with what we call three phases of education. The early years, which is the 2 years of the primary and lower primary. Then the middle school, which is the upper primary and lower secondary. And then what we call the senior school or tertiary education. When you look at the ages of learners at those levels, because that is what we looked at. We looked at the psychological developmental process of learners through the learning process. And we find that between the ages that we have marked there, their thinking, their psychological behavior, their social response is very closely related. And so it was easy to cluster them like that. But now in terms of structure, then we came up with 2 years of pre-primary, 3 years as we have it now in lower primary, 3 years of upper primary, 3 years of lower secondary, and 3 years of senior secondary. Now on the right is what we have done this time around for special needs learners. Now what we have done for special needs learners, first of all, is to appreciate that first of all, special needs are so many, they're so different, and their approach is different. There are those, again, who are severe, and those who are mild, and the way that the education and learning is provided is dictated by their level, the level of severity of their of their disability. Now that is, I think it may not be very clear, but that is when you will be reading it, you will see how we have dealt with the various categories of special needs, because this is again something that had not been well conceptualized before. As I said, some of this we will read when we get now, for the 2 years of pre-primary, that is the early years, and the 2 years of the 3 years of lower primary, what we call the early years, that is how we have divided it. Now, at the end of each of those levels, we have formative and national assessment. A lot of people sometimes have mistaken this to mean examinations. Now, across the world, at every level, you can decide to do an assessment. That means you sample certain schools across the country and you give certain assessments to gauge how the learners have achieved certain competencies that you expect them to achieve at any given level. It is on that basis that you see the PISA ranking takes place. Because when you do proper sampling, then at the end of certain years you will know if you expect that maybe at the end of the 2 years in pre-primary, a child probably will have started learning people's names, started to know how to empathize, how to sympathize, how to say sorry, then you can assess that across the country, pick out a few sample schools, do your assessment, and then that will help you know how to deal with that component of learning. So when we talk of assessment, this is what we mean. We also mean that the teacher who is with this child can give us a record, and give us a record, this is how this child behaves when they're put with others. Are they aggressive? Are they people who share their things with others? And that becomes a critical component of learning so that you know what to strengthen and what to discourage. Because if you don't do that at that level, then later, in later years, we decide that you want to make somebody very good, yet you never inculcated in that, then in that in them, it becomes a big problem. Now, at this level, these are what we call the learning areas. They are basically activities. For those of you who may have visited some of the schools where we were doing the pilot, you must have seen that there were a lot of activities that the learners were engaged in, because we are trying to avoid pumping too much content in learners at that level. Because then school becomes a painful thing that somebody goes through because their parents have insisted and that they go to, because if they miss, the teacher will cane them. I'm sure you've had cases where children say that a child is sick, you want to take them to the hospital and they tell you they have to go to school because they will be caned, they will be beaten, you know. So we have to remove that conception of learning and give it something else. Now, middle school, which is the 3 years of upper primary and 3 years of junior secondary, also has formative assessment and national assessment. Now, it is good to mention categorically that basically we are removing and we are recommending we don't need examinations at the end of primary schooling. As it is now, the exam we see simply isolate children who supposedly go to good schools and those who should not go to good schools. And therefore we start condemning them at that stage without necessarily considering the sociocultural context and even the economic environment where they're learning. So we have recommended very strongly that we do away with the national examinations at the end of primary schooling and deal with assessments at that level. Already, as it were, the government has already given a directive that I think from next year, 2019, they want 100% transition from primary school to secondary schools. Another problem that I know arises is that we basically conceive secondary schooling in terms of boarding. Again, some of you could be aware that we are one of the few countries in the world where secondary schooling is simply conceived in terms of boarding schools. Rwanda did away with that. I'm sure those of you who have been there know that very few schools in Rwanda now are boarding schools. In many parts of the world, there's nothing like boarding schools. If they're there, they're there for special reasons, and there are very few. Ours is 100% boarding. That is something that I know the government is trying to deal with so that all, if possible, all junior secondary schools become day schools. I think it's a process that is ongoing to enhance their access from one level to another. I know somebody will ask me, but then how does somebody go to a small village school vis-a-vis a big, good school? Given a chance, we'd have all your good schools remain for senior secondary, and some of them become for junior secondary. And I know that discussion is being undertaken by the ministry now. Now, in senior secondary, I'm just about to wind up. We have three pathways, as you can see them there. For those of you who went through the formal structure, it is almost close but not similar to what we used to have as A levels. The only thing we have done is to make sure that at this level, learning is as expanded as it can be, so that your schools that can offer some of the technical subjects can accommodate as much as you can, and you also collaborate with the technical institutes around your schools so that some of the learners can also go there for the practical subjects. By the time some children finish or learners finish senior school, they get what we call dual certification. They get certification for the artisanship or whatever technical skill they've been involved in, and they also get certification for getting involved in, or rather having finished senior school. So we have three pathways: sports, arts, sports and sports sciences, social sciences, science, technology and engineering and mathematics. And then under each of those pathways, we have tracks. For example, under arts and sports, we have sports as a track. I can see some of my colleagues are playing until they're opening up their mouths. Looking at the lights upstairs. I know some people could have traveled overnight. I don't know when they started some. But one or two of our colleagues, we are lucky they're not snoring. That means they're in deep, deep prayer. But I think we can still manage. So, under the art sports pathway, you have the sports track. Those of you will agree with me, there are people who at that level, maybe they just want to become runners, they just want to become footballers. But most critically, you can do sports science without being a sports person at that level, so that you are able to manage and train, give a sports person the skills that they require. So at that level, maybe what they need is communication skills, some basic entrepreneurship skills, and people relations. So that when they go outside there to do their running, they're able to communicate, they're able to relate, and they're able to know how to invest their money. Some of them just want to become actors. Maybe at the end of it all, your house helps, and maybe some of us, not necessarily household, will reduce watching the Nigerian movies and also watch ours, because it is an industry. Some people just want to become comedians. And these days you see people like Churchill being called celebrities because they're comedians, they make people happy. And maybe there are a few others who want to be like them. They are happy. They're contributing to this economy. So you don't force them to go and do maths, to do maybe biology, as much as they need it for certain basic skills. But that is what we are trying to do by creating the various pathways. So like in sports, these are what we are recommending as core subjects and what we are saying as optional subjects. So things like ethical, legal and ethical issues in sports. If you become a trainer, and that is why sometimes even our runners have managers who are based out of the country. People who never stepped on a track to run are their managers, because they did sports science and they're able to train them on how to handle themselves, how to relate with people, how to communicate. They don't give them any other special skills. There are things that we can acquire in our schools and move on also to be trainers. When you come to performing arts, again, theater, location, we have what we call the core subjects, which are basically based on our being relating with others, the basic skills, and then you pick what you think you can do. I said last year or 2 years ago, when the UK modified what they called the DJing, the exam for DJing, the people who are DJs, the schools had modified the exam for those who want to become DJ. So they call it DJing. And when we looked at it, we thought they were joking. Yet there are people who go into that, they earn a living based on that, and their lives are happy. That is still better than telling them their failures, and they go back to village, or they go back somewhere to be recruited by other people to come and kill their fellow Kenyans. So that they don't feel rejected, they people appreciate that the skills they have are useful, and useful to this country. Then we have visual arts, we have the options and the core subjects, we have the languages, and how we have recommended. I think some of this we will read and see, because this is not cast in stone. The curriculum will be rolled out in gradually, so some of these things with feedback are still being improved, they're not cast in stone. Then you come to pure sciences, applied sciences, technical and engineering. You can see that a lot of the core subjects like community service learning, physical education, ICT, remain the same, because these are skills that we all must go through. Then we have career and technology studies. Now this is an area that will attract a lot of learners. We want some of these areas to be done in school, so that by the time someone is leaving school, if they just want to become a beauty therapist, they already have some of these basic skills. And we don't consider them that they have done that because they are failures, that you have failed so you can go into technical. No, it becomes somebody's area of interest, so that you don't behave like that, if you have seen that advert on TV, where some young man calls the parents and tells the mother that I want to become a rapper. And the mother nearly throws away the phone because she cannot believe, what is that animal called a rapper? What is a rapper? Because in her perception, that thing called a rapper are meant for failures. You know, a real person should go for real things. These are things that we want to work on in terms of attitude. Now, then we have what we call pertinent and contemporary issues. These are cross-cutting. So they will run across all the learning areas in terms of the content that we have in the materials, the curriculum support materials, and even within the pedagogy, issues of gender, culture-related issues, life skills education, environmental issues. So this one will cut across all the learning areas. The materials will be developed in such a way that when you're teaching maths, you teach in such a manner that somebody acquires some extra skills. This can even be in the terms of the names that are used in books, the kind of activities that the characters in the books are being allocated are not stereotyped to mean that maybe certain people can only do certain tasks. Now, these are programs that will also, we call this one programs because they will go beyond the classrooms. There are things that will be done in sports, will be done, should be inculcated within the school environment, because they are critical in supporting who we are as a people. The main thing is that we want to get the parents a little more involved in the education of their learners, and not just coming to walk around to what I would call ritually be told that your child got an A in English and B in this, I want them to improve in this. I think you've seen when you're called to school to go on parents' education days. It's a long line. The teacher is impatient, the parents are impatient, they want to go back somewhere. So they run through, then they go to the religious education teacher, to the maths teacher. By the time they're living there, they have forgotten completely which one the child is doing better in and what they're trying to do with their parents. But if you don't go, your child will tell you they'll be sent away. So it's a ritual we go through. Now we want them to be more engaged, and with the structures that we have, I'm sure we can do it better. And we are developing guidelines on all these areas and how they can be enhanced within the school environment. Now, currently, we have developed the curriculum designs. The curriculum is being piloted. The pilot is going on. We've already got a lot of feedback from the pilot, the M&E. We have had experts from UNESCO who also worked with us through this, going across the country to see how the pilot is going ongoing. As we talk now, the curriculum experts are looking at the designs with the feedback from the pilot, but the pilot schools will continue into the third term. The pilot was strictly in standard 1 and 2, and the 2 years of pre-primary, because the rollout will be gradual, and because that is the best way to deal with a complete change of philosophy of learning in our country. So these are the stages we have gone through, what it involves, and assessment becomes a critical component of the process. And now this is what is contained in the designs that of course we will have in the school, because the designs basically is what translates into the syllabuses. Because when we're dealing with the design, we are even to produce the number of the amount of time that somebody will take to learn a specific area. I'm sure maybe some of you have been part of our experts. I should have mentioned that curriculum designs has been done by the teachers, lecturers across the country at all levels. What KICD does is provide expertise and also provide what we call 2 secretaries for every subject. But otherwise, the whole process is done by teachers who are in the classroom, because they know better how learners deal with specific situations. We have also identified what we call learning outcomes, what we expect at the end of every learning cycle. For example, when we talk of early years, what is it that we expect the learner to demonstrate? What we used to call the objectives at the end of learning. We are focusing more on what they can demonstrate than necessarily what they can remember. And this is what we have developed in terms of curriculum support materials, and this will be done across the whole education spectrum, just to help teachers see how to deal with certain learning areas within. As you are aware, we also developed the digital content, and we're still going to expand the same to make learning a little more flexible. This is what the curriculum reform means for us: a review of staffing, you know, revised staffing norms. These ones we have developed together with the TSC, and we are developing guidelines on how this can be done. The most critical thing is that we are changing the training of teachers so that the lowest trained teacher will be diploma. We are recommending the removal of certificate courses, because from the research that we did, we found teachers feeling that the practicum they have is never well structured and is too short. Some even come for teaching practice at the end of their degree program. Yet the practice is supposed to help people identify certain skills, get information from the mature teachers who are mentoring them, and then go back and use that to improve the training of teachers. As it is now, it is a ritual, not necessarily. And even if you look at the assessment model that universities use, it's completely outdated and is based on theories that no longer apply in this day and age. By the way, I think I'm talking as a teacher, I'm also talking as somebody who was teaching, training teachers and went out for assessment. And I look at how those assessments are done, you know, where 5 minutes introduction, what are they supposed to say, maybe 15 minutes content, you know, it is so ritualistic that if you go for assessment and a learner adopts a more creative, or a teacher, a trainee teacher adopts a more creative approach, then they will get 0, because they have not spent 5 minutes for introduction, maybe 20 minutes for content completely. You know, then you start wondering then, what creativity are we training them or inculcating with them? These are still the implications. I think what is critical here is what we call the retooling of the teachers. As we roll out the curriculum gradually, the training that will take place, of course, starting with school head teachers and school principals, will be fairly intensive. And that is why it has to be done gradually. For the pilot school, for example, we started by training the curriculum support officers and the head teachers before we went to train the teachers in those schools, because the head teachers and principals are expected to provide instructional leadership. And this is one thing that we have been discussing with Kemi, because the training we have in Kemi is more management oriented. That is something, management is something that is shared. Your buzz are giving some components. You only need certain basic financial skills. You don't need to be a finance officer. You don't need to, be an expert in procurement. You only need basic skills. The main thing that we need as principals is instructional leadership. That is what you are. Because basically you are a teacher first, then being a principal becomes more of a responsibility. Again, I don't want to spend too much time on that because that is my area of study, and sometimes I get so passionate about it. This is how we conducted the pilot, how we selected the schools, rural, urban, public, private, special needs. All of them were selected across the 47 counties. This is how we sampled the schools, the head teachers, etc. I think this may not necessarily be. This is how we plan to do the implementation. Now, the component that I know is critical teacher attributes. We are also, should have mentioned that we have also been engaging universities, all the public and private universities, their deans and vice chancellors and principals have had these presentations. We have had engagements with them, and some of the universities are already engaging us to help them see how they can modify their curriculum. You will agree with me because, again, I went through this when I was teaching at the university. What we call developing curriculum at the university is simply opening websites. If you want to do course in communication or certain elements of education, you open certain universities, find what they have done, copy paste and adjust, modify, and you have a degree program. Now that I know better, developing a curriculum involves a lot more than that. Because really we need to think by the end of this, what kind of person we have. Is it just the content we are interested in, or we are also looking at certain other skills. Training on pedagogy and approaches, those ones are also included. I think we have already mentioned about paradigm shift. This is assessment in competence-based curriculum. We have something called assessment as learning, which you will read when you're given the material. We have assessment for learning, and that is the most critical. That when we assess, we should assess to identify the areas that we need to improve on so that learning can take place much better. What we have in the country now is assessment of learning. We train, then we assess. And when we assess, it is not relevant. It's only relevant in terms of getting the grade, but not to help us become or make our learning better. Those are the. Now, these are the critical components of instructional leadership, and that is what we need to be as school leaders. When you look at it, you see things like shared vision. I know many schools that I've been to now have developed their strategic plan, their mission, their vision. The main thing is to identify something that you can relate with, not something that you just need to put there so that if the inspectors came, they see that you have a vision or mission. If you left there and you are in the field and somebody asked you as a principal, what basically is your mission or vision as a school? You start wondering that, you know, we just did it the other day and yet to internalize it. But if you come next time, definitely you'll get your answer. So it's basically just being a flexible person, understanding the learning much better than your teachers. It doesn't mean you have to understand all the subjects, but the basic learning environment is something that, because once you understand it, it's when you can drive it. You are the one who is leading them there. You must project a lot further than what your teachers can do. So those are critical dimensions of instructional leadership that we'll also be working with KEMI and other agencies to make sure that they are well embedded within the leadership process. It includes allocation of resources, management of systems and processes, etc. This is the value of communities of practice, which is also critical. One of the most critical components is a group of teachers coming together, teachers in specific learning areas and subjects, coming together to assess how their learners react in different schools to what they do. sharing challenges and achievements. Incidentally, Shanghai, which is the best ranked teacher education country now in terms of learning outcomes, this is what they do. The privilege of being taken by the World Bank alongside the TSE, a large team from the TSE, to go and check what is it that they do differently. And one of the things they do is they call research. It's not the kind of research that we know. It's just teachers once in a month coming together in a given zone, sharing experiences, identifying challenges, and coming up with modalities of how to deal with the challenges better and the form of community of practice. Because they're not in a hurry to finish the syllabus. You know, the problem we have now, and I'm sure you principals know this better, I saw it when I was teaching in school, at the beginning of the year, you want each of your teachers to account for their column. If your column has not done well, you have to explain why and what you want to do about it. And that is why we want to embed a formative assessment so that we don't just rely on the summative evaluation. And now, we hope next year, this has not been farmed up in terms of the stages. One thing that we are clear about is that we are ready to roll out the new curriculum next year. The comprehensive training of teachers has been planned for November into December in various zones. Most of the CSOs are already trained, because next year we want to roll out in pre-primary and lower primary, 1 to 3. Most of the training has already taken place, but this will be expanded. And once that happens, then we'll be rolling out successively as we move on until we get to where we are supposed to be. We still have two models that are being discussed. One would end in about 6 years, another one would be a bit longer. Because as we roll out, we also understand that we'll need certain infrastructural changes in the way that our secondary schools are set now to prepare them for about 3 to 4, 5 years before we get to where we are. I think that is all I had. I've tried to say as much.